Hey everybody, Mike here. Welcome to part two of my camera basics mini series that I'm doing on the channel where we're talking about three basic topics in photography and videography, and that is aperture, shutter speed, and ISO. And today in this video, we're gonna be talking about shutter speed. Okay, let's jump right into this here and answer the question, what is shutter speed? Shutter speed can best be described as the length of time that film or a digital sensor inside of a camera is exposed to light. So this happens when the shutter is open when taking a photograph. It's literally the act of the shutter opening and closing, thus exposing the film or digital sensor, like I said, to light. And shutter speed is essentially the amount of time that that shutter is open. It's pretty easy stuff, but we're gonna talk about how it applies to photography first, and then at the end of the video, we'll talk a little bit about video. So just in case you guys hear any weird noises during this video, my dog Remy is on the floor behind me chewing a bone. Okay, so just as an FYI, all SLR cameras and most point and shoot cameras have settings within them that will allow you to change and adjust your shutter speed through the settings. Cell phones do as well, but if you're like me and you have an iPhone, then you're gonna need to download a third-party app that's going to give you access to the manual controls within that camera. So shutter speed basically controls two things. It helps to control the exposure in the image as well as the motion in that image. Exposure is controlled by shutter speed by the act of that actual physical shutter either opening or closing slower or faster, and that determines the amount of light that is collected by the image sensor or the film inside the camera as that passes through the lens. Motion in the image is determined by the length of time, either long or short, that the shutter is open as well. Okay, so let's real quick talk about how it's shown, because in order to understand this, you actually need to know how it's written or how it's portrayed on the back of your camera, so that you can understand which settings you're using and how that affects your image. So it's shown either as a fraction or as a whole numerical number that is representative of seconds. And like I said, you really have to think of this as time, because that is exactly what we're talking about. We're talking about the amount of time that the shutter on the camera is open when you take an image. So on one hand of the spectrum, you have really fast shutter speeds, and on the other hand, you have really slow shutter speeds. And in the middle, you've got a varying degree between there. But basically, that's what this boils down to, is extremely fast shutter speeds and extremely slow shutter speeds. Okay, so let's take a look at some examples so you guys can understand what I'm talking about here. For example, you can see on your screen now, 1/1000. So basically what this means is 1/1000th of a second. So this means that the shutter is open for 1/1000th of a second, and this would be a really, really fast shutter speed. Another example we can look at here is 1/125. So this would be 1/125th of a second. Taking a look at another example here, we've got 1/4, which would basically be 1/4th of a second, and this is gonna be a lot slower even than 1/125. And this is a very slow shutter speed. And going even slower, we can look at things like actual seconds. So like 5 seconds, 10 seconds, even something like 1 second. That's gonna be a lot slower of a shutter speed than 1/4 or 1/125 or 1/1000. So these are just some examples, guys. Obviously, you know, every camera is gonna be a little bit different. For example, my camera here shoots at shutter speeds as fast as 1/8000 or 1/8000th of a second, all the way up to as slow of a shutter speed as 30 seconds. So that shutter is open for a full 30 seconds. And obviously there's settings throughout that I can adjust and change depending on whatever I'm shooting. Just as a quick side note though, most SLR cameras have what's called a bulb mode. That's the little B on your dial. And basically what that is, it just allows you to have your shutter open for the length of time that your camera shutter button is pressed. So when you press to take a picture, you can hold that down and keep that shutter open for as long as you want. And that's basically the functionality of bulb mode. So on the back of some cameras, when you're messing around with your settings, the shutter speed is actually represented as just a solid number. So it's not gonna be shown as a fraction. And I'll show you guys a video clip here real quick of what my camera looks like. Every camera, like I said, is different, but this is essentially what my camera looks like. And this number, unless it's indicated with quotations, which would be signaling seconds, is essentially the number that is on the bottom of that fraction. So if your camera says something like 60, that is essentially the shutter speed, and it would basically be 1/60 or 1/60th of a second. So if my camera then said 10 with the quotation marks on it, then basically the shutter speed would be 10 seconds. Okay, so now that we understand how shutter speed is written and how it looks on the back of your camera, let's talk about what it actually does and how it affects your images in photography. Okay, so as I mentioned a minute ago, you know that shutter speed affects both your exposure and your motion. And the motion can actually sort of be broken down into two categories, either freezing of the motion or slowing down and letting in more motion blur into your image. And you know, I mean, on the scale here, you're gonna get a varying degree of blur as you adjust your shutter speeds. But to better demonstrate this, I'm gonna head out into the field and take some photos. I'm gonna bring you guys with me and show you exactly what I'm talking about. Okay, so I had every intention of leaving the house, but it's raining right now, so we're just gonna stay inside. I'm gonna do these examples for you guys in my basement with my ping pong table and a ping pong ball. So basically what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna roll this ball across the table and I'm gonna take two separate photographs, each with a different shutter speed. So one's gonna have a fast shutter speed and one's gonna have a slow shutter speed. And I'm gonna show you you guys the differences. Okay, so the first image here, this was taken with a shutter speed of 1/320. So this was 1/320th of a second. And as you can see, the ping pong ball is really crisp. There's basically no motion blur here at all. And for all intents and purposes, you really can't tell that this ball is moving. Essentially, this fast shutter speed allowed me to freeze the motion of the ball as it was going across the table. Now, contrastly, in the second image, I actually used a shutter speed of 1 second. So you can see the difference here. It's very dramatic, but you can actually see a ton of motion blur in this image. The shutter was open for a full second, so it captured a lot of that ball moving across the table. There's a long trail of that ball as it moved across the table, and there's apparent motion in this image. You can obviously tell that something was moving through the frame. So obviously, as you can see side by side, these are very different images, and I tried to do this on purpose to give you an example of one extreme versus the other extreme. Obviously, there's gonna be varying degrees of this amount of blur in your images depending on what shutter speed you use. But these are two basic examples where you can see one image that was taken with a really fast shutter speed and what that created, and an image that was taken with a really slow shutter speed and what that created. Okay, so now that we understand how shutter speeds work, let's talk about some creative uses within photography, both for fast and slow shutter speeds. So for fast shutter speeds, people do some really cool stuff with this, like water droplet photography, or dropping cool items into aquariums and freezing that motion instantly so you can see all the little bubbles and all that stuff that's in the water. Also, sports photographers use really fast shutter speeds as well, because look, let's face it, nobody wants to look at an image of a basketball player going up for a dunk and have that be all blurry. What they want to see is the beads of sweat on their face. They want to see the position of the ball cocked back behind their head as they're about to throw it down. They want to see the expression on that person's face. They want to see the expression on the defender's face as he realizes he's going to become the victim of this dunk and might be embarrassed by having this clip shown on ESPN SportsCenter's top 10 the next day. That's what they want to see. That's why sports photographers use really fast shutter speeds. There's a lot of other applications for fast shutter speeds as well, but those are just some examples. So let's quickly talk about some examples and creative ways to use slow shutter speeds. Slow shutter speeds are used to blur the subject in your image, and those can be used in images like this where you're showing somebody that's running or jumping and you want to show action or movement in your image. Some other creative uses for slower shutter speeds are for creating images with light trails. So if you want to show the movement of cars or lights, or if you've got an image where you want to paint light actually on your image or draw things, like those are all really fun creative things to try with slower shutter speeds. Star trails are another one. As you can see here, there's the star trails going across the sky. Slower shutter speeds allow you to capture things like that. Same with stuff like this where you've got blurred clouds. Also, water is a very popular subject to capture with slower shutter speeds. So you can either have images like this where you take slower shutter speeds of a waterfall and it makes it look all dreamy and silky smooth looking. Same with ocean waves as well. I've seen really cool images like this where people do slower shutter speed effects on their photos to capture the movement of ocean waves. You can also do a technique called panning, which is basically where you take your camera and your shutter speed is quite slow, but you're actually moving at the same speed of your subject. So the subject in your image actually stays in focus and isn't blurred at all, but the background behind them is blurred. So it still gives the effect of motion, but it allows the person viewing the image to focus on that subject, and it gives kind of a nice creative effect behind them as well. If you have a zoom lens, you can actually do this kind of creative technique where you actually zoom in your lens slowly while you push down on the shutter and let that shutter speed stay open. I actually went to a local pet store to check this out. They have some little fish tanks with some crabs in it, and so I decided to try this out. Here was the image that I got.
Time is money!
Nah, I'm just kidding. That's a Mr. Krabs meme from SpongeBob. I actually didn't go to the pet store. I probably should have. It would have been a lot of fun. But here's some images anyway of some stuff that I found online with this technique that you can check out and sort of kind of get the idea of what I'm talking about there. So anyways, those are just some examples. You can go experiment with those and find out what you like or what fits your style. But those are just some creative ideas. I'm sure there's a lot more out there, but those are just some ones that I thought of off the top of my head for why people use slower shutter speeds and how they're creatively used in photography. And I should mention as well that sometimes you actually have to use a slower shutter speed depending on what you need for exposure. So if you need more light into your image, you may need to compensate with a slower shutter speed to allow more light to enter in and properly expose that photograph. Okay, so let's talk about videography and how does shutter speed affect videos. I'm not really gonna go into too many specifics on this. All you really need to know is a simple rule, and that is essentially that anytime you shoot video, if you wanna have normal looking motion blur in that image, you're gonna want your shutter speed to be double your frame rate. So what I mean by that is that if you're shooting, let's say, a film or a movie in 24 frames per second, your shutter speed on your camera for that video setting, you're gonna need that to be double your frame rate in order to capture normal motion blur. So what you're gonna do is you're gonna do simple math, 24, or I guess you'd be shooting in 23.98 frames a second, but essentially you're shooting in 24 frames a second, multiply that by 2, you're gonna get 48. Most cameras don't do a shutter speed of 1/48, so you're actually just gonna bump that up, round up, to 1/50, and that's gonna be the shutter speed you're gonna wanna shoot at for normal looking motion blur in a 24 frames per second video. If you're shooting video at 30 frames per second, you're gonna wanna use 1/60 for your shutter speed. If you're shooting at 60 frames per second, you're gonna wanna use a shutter speed of 1/120, or actually I think my camera does like 1/125, it doesn't do 1/120. So whatever's closest to those is what you're gonna wanna shoot at. And if you're shooting at 120 frames per second, you're gonna wanna have a shutter speed of 1/240. Now again, if you're shooting at 24 frames per second in this example, no camera's gonna allow you to shoot below what the actual frames per second is. So you're not gonna be able to shoot at a frame rate that's lower than 24 in this 24 frames per second example, okay? But like I said, if you wanna capture normal motion blur in a video, you're gonna wanna double your frame rate and make that bottom number of your shutter speed double that of your frame rate. There's some creative differences and little things you can try, but for the sake of the basics video, I'm just giving you guys that rule so that you understand it. And this might be a topic we could go into in a later video. All right guys, so that's gonna wrap this up for today. I hope that you learned something. If you guys did, or if you enjoyed the video, please be sure to hit that thumbs up button on the video and make sure you guys subscribe as well. The next video we're gonna be talking about, we're gonna be covering the topic of ISO, and that's going to round out the third part of our three-part mini series here covering camera basics. So I'd hate for you guys to miss out on that if this is a series that you're enjoying. So make sure you subscribe. Once you do that, also be sure to click the bell icon as well, because YouTube does a really bad job of just pushing videos out to subscriber sub boxes. So if you click that bell icon, then you'll be sure to get a notification the next time you log into YouTube. Also, I've got links to like my Twitter, Discord, Instagram, Facebook, all that stuff down in the description. I post announcements on all those whenever I post a new video. So guys, make sure you follow me on those as well. And yeah, thank you so much for watching. I hope you guys enjoyed the video, and I will see you guys in the next one. Peace.